You're listening to Thera Chronicles with Dr. Rosie and Dr. Krish. This health awareness series is brought to you by Therachron, tailoring therapy.
Hey, hello. I'm Dr. Rosie.
Hi, I'm Dr. Krish. We welcome you to the second episode of Season 1 of Thera Chronicles.
And today, we are going to talk to a doctor who is 30 and diabetic.
So, in our previous episode, we talked about what diabetes is and how it is caused. We also elucidated the different types of diabetes. If you missed out on the last episode, do click onto the link for the same in the description below.
Today, we are in conversation with Dr. Avish Karmokal. Dr. Avish Kar is a consultant orthodontist in Mumbai. Well, he's 30 and diabetic. In our discussion today, he will be taking us through his journey of being affected by diabetes.
So, welcome to Thera Chronicles, Avish Kar. It is one of those unusual days when you are on the other side of the table, right? So, can you please go ahead and tell our audience a little bit about yourself?
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Avish Karmokal. I'm an orthodontist. I'm Krish's immediate senior. So, I am attached to Mumbai Port Trust Hospital as a locum medical officer. Okay. And I am attached to other hospitals as well as a consultant orthodontist. Plus, I have my own private practice in Navi Mumbai. So, with respect to my work, it generally involves working in the hospitals during the day. That is from 9 to 5:30-ish. And then around 6:30 onwards, I go to my private clinic. So, with respect to my day-to-day life, it is pretty hectic.
Yes, must be.
And whatever off days that I get, I generally end up doing consultations where I go to other clinics and work.
Okay.
So, work-wise, I'm pretty jam-packed. I am my parents' only son. I do not have any siblings and I'm not married. So, yeah, that's that.
And what about your hobbies? Like, what do you do in your leisure?
I've learned the tabla for 7 years and I play a lot of percussions. But because of the schedule that I mentioned, it is impossible for me to go back and play something because I'm tired at the end of the day.
Right. Must be.
So getting back to diabetes, as far as I know, you have been diagnosed with diabetes for a few years now. Could you please run us through your journey of being diabetic? I mean, how did it all start and how did you get to know about it and how has it been since then?
Okay, so my first encounter with, I won't say diabetes, my first encounter with really high blood sugar happened in my third year post-graduation where life was pretty screwed up professionally also and personally also. Plus, we had I had a similar schedule which was there. So, I used to stress eat a lot. So, that one day eventually gave in to very high blood sugar, which I encountered just suddenly one day when I felt a lot of flushing. I sweated a lot in a span of 5 minutes and there was very high heartbeat. And so, that is one of the times when I consulted my general physician and he told me to go and get my blood sugar done. So, after giving the blood sugar, I got a call from the lab after say around 2 hours and stating that, sir, I think you need to get hospitalized because your random blood sugar is 363.
That's really high.
We checked it thrice. So we are pretty sure that it is accurate.
Okay.
So once that happened, then I again consulted my physician and then I went. That time they didn't directly consider me into the diabetic group. They just felt it was one of the times when probably I had high blood sugar. Then I started with the food control, stopped sweets completely, plus did the regular thing of having Kerala juice and aloe vera juice. So that helped me that time. But then I feel the basic reason I have diabetes is first it is hereditary because both my parents are diabetic. Not my mom presently, but my mom's parents, my grandparents were diabetic. So I have a very strong genetic predisposition for it. And the second thing is my big schedule and a lot of stress eating. So I think this led to where I am right now presently with respect to diabetes. Okay. So currently in November when I had gotten it checked, my HbA1c was 8.3.
Oh.
But luckily just this past few weeks when I got it checked, it has come down to 6.6 now. But I am on medication. I am on glycomate once a day, every day, plus multivitamin tablets.
Okay.
And obviously the typical diet control and some amount of exercise.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm with respect to diabetes, I'm here right now.
Okay.
So considering you have had diabetes running in your family, how did your parents and family react when they came to know about your diabetic status?
My dad was furious.
Okay.
Because since a very young age, he used to tell me that both your grandparents from both the sides are diabetic and you're like a ticking time bomb. So my father, if you meet him any day, he's extremely fit at the age of 59 also.
Oh, that's wonderful.
He exercises, he does yoga, and the entire fit life he's living. And in spite of being so healthy, he is still diabetic.
Ah.
So looking at my lifestyle and my weight and my habits, he had predicted it ki 100% you will become a diabetic. So when I got high blood sugar in my third year post-graduation, when I was 27 years of age, he was extremely furious. In spite of telling you to take care of yourself, you didn't.
Right.
And now you're in a soup.
Mm-hmm.
So family's first reaction was anger and frustration.
I can imagine.
Eventually, my reaction initially was not that great. I wasn't too surprised because I knew how I was living and what I was eating. But later, when the food restrictions came in, and like I told you, because one of the reasons I am a stress eater, because I like eating sweets and junk food when I'm stressed, that helps me relieve it a bit.
Okay.
So that restriction came. So when I have nothing food-wise, when I couldn't relieve my stress, then I slowly started turning towards smoking and alcohol.
Okay.
But that didn't help much, because the good feeling that I got with food, I didn't get it with alcohol or smoking.
Okay.
So anger and frustration are the only two things that I can describe.
Okay.
The reaction as.
Okay. So dietary changes must have been a challenge. But I'm sure that's not all of it, right? Can you share with us what were the changes and challenges that you had to undergo to ensure adequate attention to your health after you were diagnosed with diabetes? Like, say, for allocating some time to exercising and being compliant with daily medications.
I suddenly got shifted from a young age group to a bad health predisposition group, a high risk group that we see.
Yeah, yeah.
So especially right now also when I was working in COVID, so that time it was risky. I mean, my parents also didn't readily agree for me to be working in a COVID ward or even in a COVID hospital. So I had to be more careful.
Okay.
That is slightly irritating at this age.
Yeah, it is. It is irritating.
Other than that, the dietary restrictions were okay. I had to consider them as a part and parcel of my life. But then the sudden thing where I have to be very, very careful about how I'm dealing with my patients and how I'm roaming around and whether I'm wearing my mask or not. Especially with this entire COVID thing that is happening, there's a lot of caution that is there in my life.
True.
So that is slightly irritating.
So Avishkar, when we started the conversation, you mentioned how busy your schedule is. How about you share with us your daily routine? Like how a regular day in your life looks like, your timings for food, medication and so on.
Okay, so because my father has been a diabetic since the past 10 years, he has done a lot of research and he has attended a lot of shows where they tell you what to eat and what not to eat, and then they incorporate a lot of things. So one of the things that he has incorporated in all of our lives is something called as a smoothie.
Oh, interesting.
So it involves a bunch of green leafy vegetables and certain ingredients. So that generally shifts your body pH to a slightly alkaline pH early in the morning. So everybody in my house gets up and has that smoothie first.
Well, I'm very interested in that. I'm sure all our listeners are also interested to know about this smoothie.
Okay, so the ingredients include palak, tulsi, kadi patta, any fruit. So he generally prefers an apple or a pomegranate. Then there's salt, pepper, some amount of dhania powder, and either lime, and either you can have some sauce put into it. You can have it with a natural fruit juice and you can smoothen it up, or with water.
That actually sounds tasty. I mean, I didn't expect it to, but it does.
Yeah, it is. It is not that bad. I mean, it looks like algae, but it's not that bad.
So, most of these ingredients are anyway good for health. And coincidentally, I also happened to come across some research articles recently which talks about positive effect of curry leaves in controlling type 2 diabetes. So your dad must have done his homework really well.
Yeah.
So post the smoothie, I have my glycomate. And now with respect to the work schedule that I have, it is, I generally don't like having breakfast for whatever reason. I've always been a brunch kind of a person. So rather than having breakfast at 7:30, 8:30 in the morning, I prefer eating something at 11:30. So I'm sorted for the morning also and for the afternoon also. Okay. Again, this can directly be led to the PG life that I had, where I didn't get time for lunch, nor did I get time for breakfast. So post our seminars, we generally used to go hog a bit and then start working.
Yes, possible.
So that habit stuck with me. So now also, I try to keep it a 2-meal-a-day kind of a thing, where I skip my breakfast. Luckily, I do not have any side effects after having glycomate early in the morning, which people generally do, by the way. They feel some amount of flushing, they feel hypoglycemic because they've had the medicine. So I luckily don't feel that. So I still skip my breakfast, but then I come home for lunch. I make it a point to come home for lunch, which is around 1:30.
Okay.
And then post everything, I have my dinner at around 7:38. So these are the two primary meals that I have every day.
No snacking in between?
Now, in between at times, if I get some free time, then I can have some nuts or a small fruit here and there, but generally that doesn't happen.
Okay.
So I'm restricted myself to a 2-meal-a-day kind of a thing. And yeah, a lot of green tea. Every chance that I get, carry a big tumbler of green tea with me. So even in the hospital, between two cases or when I'm doing my admin work, I just keep sipping on green tea.
Okay.
So primarily this is what I do.
Great.
Then because we are non-vegetarian people, so my cheat days include having some fish or some chicken here and there. But again, I try to incorporate that in a 2-meal-a-day thing.
Okay.
So I'm pretty happy with it. I don't feel the need to snack in between. And if those two meals are sufficiently tasty, so I don't feel the need to stress it also. So I'm happy with the way things are right now.
Okay.
You're listening to Thera Chronicles with Dr. Rosie and Dr. Krish. This health awareness series is brought to you by Therachron, tailoring therapy.
Okay. Now, Avishkar, apart from a sudden shooting hyperglycemic episode, which made you discover that you were diabetic accidentally, did you have any other incident where diabetes caused an emergency or acute hospitalization or triggered any other health condition for you?
One of the things that we suddenly started noticing was whenever I have high blood sugar, or there is some fluctuation in my blood sugar, I get a lot of acne and I get a lot of abscesses. Generally, initially, they could have been diagnosed as infected sebaceous, but then those were not it. So I get small pustules on my skin. So whenever such things start happening, then it is a direct correlation that we have found that that is the time my blood sugar is fluctuating or it is high.
Okay. Okay.
So other than that, I have not noticed anything else. The only hospitalization or a scare that I noticed was when my RBS was 363. Other than that, recent times, nothing of that sort has happened, luckily.
Okay, that is good to know. Now, you have already run us through it a little bit, but we would like to learn more about how has the COVID-19 pandemic and the lockdown affected your life as a diabetic patient, say in terms of getting connected to your doctor or getting your medication or lab reports and so on.
Luckily, because we live in a very tech-savvy age, the lab was not an issue. The consultations were not an issue because everything happened over WhatsApp. The only thing that changed, especially in the first 2 or 3 months of the lockdown, was because my father being a diabetic and me and my mom, we were continuously working in the COVID hospital. So we couldn't expect my father to continuously go to the market and get the routine things that we used to get. And then online deliveries were also not there in the first few months of the lockdown. So all the protein bars or all the other healthy accessory stuff that at times used to be there in the house, we couldn't get those. And we couldn't do a lot of chochlas on the smoothie as well. At times, these particular green leafy vegetables weren't available to us.
Yes, yes.
And the only widely available things was dal chawal and roti sabzi.
Yes.
So then we still stuck to the two meal routine, but then we ended eating a lot of rice. Yeah, that is one thing I forgot to mention, that we cut down on rice a lot. So I either used to have 2 chapatis and sabzi or 1 bhakri and sabzi.
Right.
But then due to the lockdown, those things were also at times hard to get. So then I used to have 1 vati of rice with a lot of dal and vegetables. But then eventually, how much ever you eat, rice is rice. So in that entire span of 5-6 months, or during the strict lockdown time, especially, me and my dad both ended up eating a lot of rice. So lab-wise or consultation-wise or anything else-wise, we weren't affected. But food-wise, yes, there were a few restrictions that were there.
Now, being a very busy professional and also diabetic, do you think there can be any changes or help in the system that can make your journey through diabetes a bit easy?
You know, me being a doctor myself and working in so many hospitals, it is very easy for me as a medico to just, during the span of my day, just randomly go to the lab and get a RBS done. Or even if I have to give fasting and postprandial blood sugar, I can just go early to work and get it done. But for common people, it is not all that easy. I mean, they have to go stand in lines, find a lab, probably take a day off from work because we have to give fasting and postprandial within a span of 2 hours. So for them, home visits of technicians, widely available technicians at a very decent rate, will be helpful. Plus, what I have noticed amongst all the people who are suffering from diabetes or hypertension or any other restrictive illness, that you constantly need somebody to keep tabs on you, whether what you are eating or how efficiently are you taking your medications or time, or are you exercising or not.
Just
like a life coach, if at all you get, then that is going to be very helpful. So some amount of what do you say, if you are made accountable for something, if there's somebody to keep tabs on you, then probably this entire thing can be much better.
So again, in the beginning of today's episode, you had told us that both sides of your family are diabetic, right? So passing the trait on to your children might be a possibility. Does it scare you?
100%. 100%. Scares the shit out of me, if you ask me. No, it is very scary because the instances of kids getting... Now, I got diabetic at the age of 27. That is shocking for most of the people. So in those situations, it becomes very scary because especially right now we are talking in COVID era.
Yeah.
So we don't know what kind of viruses or what kind of illnesses or will be there when I will have kids or they will be growing up. So when everything else is getting bad and I am genetically giving them one risky trait of mine. So it does worry me at times.
So one last question. As we mentioned earlier, you are 30 and you are diabetic. So any advice or word of caution that you want to give, especially to the young audience?
I would say everything in moderation is good. Try to get help as soon as possible. Do not stress eat like me. Now, in this day, in these days also, mental health is very important. So the only word of advice is, if you feel that there is a problem, and then if you feel that there are certain things that you cannot control, and if you feel that you need to talk to somebody about these things and get things in line, you please do that.
Absolutely.
So as the quicker you realize it, the easier it is for you to get help, and the more easier it is for you to get things under control.
True.
So be open about your problems to your parents, to your peers, to anybody else. And there is no harm in asking for help. And there is no harm in admitting that you are in a soup physically and mentally, and that you need to get things in.
Very correct.
So it was great to have you on this episode, Avishkar. I wish you all the good health and prosperity in future. And I hope you enjoyed this conversation just as much as we did.
Thank you so much, Krish and Rosy, for having me on Thera Chronicles. This allowed me to speak openly about all the things that I've gone through, and I hope this helps a lot of other people who are going through the same thing. You gave me a platform to voice my experiences as well as my opinions, and you guys are really doing a very good job with this, and I wish you guys all the best. Kudos to you and your team, and this was a pleasure.
And that was a conversation with Dr. Avishkar Mokkal, where he spoke about his story of being 30 and diabetic. And in order to know what are the health complications associated with diabetes, watch out for our next episode of Thera Chronicles, where we will be talking about the complications of diabetes.
Thank you for tuning into this episode of Thera Chronicles. Found it useful? Like, comment, and share it with your friends and family. To keep yourself updated with our latest episodes, subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon. We would love to hear from you at therachroniclespodcast@gmail.com.
The interviews present personal opinions of the guests and are generic in nature. Thera Chronicles and Therachron does not endorse to the opinions expressed by the guests. We understand that every individual is different and requires customized care. Your doctor knows the best, and the advice, opinions, and suggestions in the interviews are not an alternative to your doctor's opinion. Consult with your personal physician and experts before implementing any changes in your lifestyle, medication, and therapy. Thera Chronicles or Therachron does not have any endorsements or financial interests with any of the products, medicines, medical equipment, or brands mentioned by the guests in the interviews.